Hi everyone and welcome. Last time we loaded these models. And I hope you see what the problem is. The animals don't move at all. To make them move, we will have to implement something which is known as skeletal animation. It is not an easy to implement feature and it's very computation expensive depending on how much animated models your engine has to support. However, it's a great journey and brings awesome aliveness into game world. Let's dive into it. We can split our task into multiple stages and I'll try to explain each of these steps in much more detail. First step is loading skeleton information. Skeleton is some hierarchy of bones. This hierarchy has a root bone. Root bone has its child bones, and these child bones has their child bones. And so on. This initial set of bones, which define hierarchy, is known as bind pose or T pose. In memory, this hierarchy can be represented as an array of bone structures, where each bone contains an index to a parent bone and inverse bind pose matrix, which we will meet later in the video. The number of bones in a skeleton is usually not greater than 256. It means that we can use a number that ranges from 0 to 255 to index to any bone in that array. This number can be stored as an unsigned char, which takes only 8 bits. The second step is loading skinning information. Skinning is the process of binding the actual 3D mesh to bones in hierarchy. To know which bones affect our vertices and how, we have to store indices to bones that affect a vertex and weights that tell us how much this particular bone affects this vertex. If bone weight is 1, then it means that by moving a bone, the vertex will be fully affected by that bone. If bone weight is 0, it means that when bone will move, it won't affect a vertex at all. Values between 0 and 1 allow us to have a smooth mesh when bones are moving. So for each vertex, we additionally store indices to bones that affect this vertex and weights. Indices that are unsigned chars can be packed into unsigned integer by shifting and applying binary OR operator. 4 weights that we store must sum up to 1, and they can easily be loaded via a simp. That's true, but not in my case. A little work and everything looks great again. Step 3 is loading animation information. Imagine we have a model whose origin looks like this. Let's call the space represented by these axes a model space. And imagine we have a hierarchy of bones that look like that. If we now give a number to each bone, we can then write these bones' transformation matrices like so. Let's say that this matrix will transform any point or space from space A to space B. In our case, matrix 4 to 3 will transform anything from the space of 4th bone to space of 3rd bone. To transform a point from space of 4th bone to model space, we have to multiply all transform matrices all the way down in the hierarchy. We can write all of the other bones' transformation relative to model space like this. But where do we take these transformation matrices? We can calculate them using animation data. Let's say for simplicity that we have 2 bones. Animation data contains information about position, rotation, and scale relative to a parent of each bone at a different time. Let's say our animation is playing here right now. To know the transformations of the bones at that particular time, we can find 2 nearest frames to that timestamp. I call them previous and next frames. Find the percentage t with which we can find a new bone position, rotation, and scale relative to a parent. That percentage can be found as a ratio between A and B, where A is a time distance between current time and previous frame time, and B is the time difference between next and previous frames. Then by using this value t, we can find new position by interpolating between previous and next frame position vectors, new rotation by interpolating between previous and next frame rotation quaternions, new scale by interpolating between previous and next frame scale vectors. Now when we know a position, rotation and scale at a given time, we can calculate bond transformation matrix relative to a parent by first calculating translation, rotation and scaling matrices based on them, and then by multiplying those matrices. By calculating transformation matrices together for all the bonds, we will get all the information needed for calculating transformation matrices relative to a model space, like we've talked previously. To help me visualize bonds hierarchy, I've rendered cubes in places where bonds could be positioned. My first attempts on animating these bonds were failed due to incorrect calculation of time, where I had to interpolate nearest frames. But that was at least something. And then I managed to animate them successfully. Also, you need to understand, guys, that all of these matrix multiplications are very expensive. Each matrix multiplication is something about 64 float multiplications and 48 float additions. Imagine us having 40 bonds per model on average and 100 animated models in the scene. The number of calculations becomes incredibly high. And I'm not even talking about load and store operations to get data in and out of the matrix. In the later videos we will optimize that and make it a lot faster, but for now let's just keep that problem in mind. Step 4. Calculating and using skinning matrices. Imagine we have an arm model with two bones inside it. Left picture shows the mesh and bones in bind pose. Right one shows the pose of bones that we've calculated in the previous step. To transform a vertex of a mesh to its desired position in animated pose, we need to transform it from mesh space to local space of the bone that affects it by using inverse bind pose matrix, which we extracted from a simp. If you think about it, the local positions of a vertex relative to a bone are equal in both cases. So we can calculate animated vertex position for bone B, which is equal to the vertex local position for bone B times the transformation matrix for bone B to model space. If we substitute position for bone B, we can get the following expression. If we combine these two matrices together by multiplying them, we will get a matrix which is known as skinning matrix. Then, finding animated vertex position for a bone is as easy as multiplying mesh space vertex position with this skinning matrix. Now we can repeat the steps above to find animated vertex position for all the bones that affect our vertex. In our case, only bone A is left. And we will get another animated vertex, but now for bone A. And then we can just use weights that we stored in vertex data to calculate target animated vertex position. After repeating all of the steps for all vertices of our mesh, we will transform all vertices to their desired animated positions. The whole process of transforming vertices is called skinning. Here are some of my failures during the way of implementing skinning. That one was really close, but for a reason it had an incorrect scale. Almost ready, but eyes are big. And finally I got something like this. Look at how great and alive models look now. These fox and bear models were created by Jose Diaz. You can check out his assets at Unity Asset Store and CG Trader page. I find his works really beautiful and gorgeous. Thank you, Jose. I really hope that this video will help you to create your own skeletal animation system. At least that you will understand underlying crazy at first sight matrix transformation magic much better. I want to thank all of you guys for watching this video. It was really fun making it. Thanks a lot to my Patreon supporters, 1097x and Despera. You rock, guys. Subscribe to my channel, hit likes, leave comments, you name it. I want to see you in the next episodes. Until then, thanks you so much once again and goodbye.